Hello, everyone. Good evening. My name is Brian Jones. I'm the Associate Director of Education at the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, and I'm thrilled to welcome you to Conversations in Black Freedom Studies, virtual edition. Thank you for joining us. For the hearing impaired or anyone who wants to use live captions, we will paste instructions for viewing those in the chat window now. The Schomburg Center, a world-renowned institution dedicated to preserving and interpreting the global Black experience, is celebrating its 95th year. And to do so, we've curated a growing collection of virtual and digital offerings, such as our Black Liberation Reading List, our third annual literary festival happening next month, and this monthly series. However, starting Monday, May 10th, I'm pleased to announce that we will begin welcoming patrons back to our building on 135th Street in Harlem by appointment to conduct research in our archives in person. The first step is to schedule a virtual consultation with a Schomburg Center librarian. To do that or to continue exploring our digital and virtual resources, just visit schomburgcenter.org. The Conversations in Black Freedom Studies series is a space to talk about new works and ideas in Black social movement history. Tonight, we consider three stories from the history of Black music, Black music being one of the most powerful and influential ways that Black people have expressed joy and pain, have spoken truth and galvanized social movements. To guide us in understanding this history, we're so fortunate to have three fabulous authors. In a moment, we'll introduce Hanif Abdurraqib, author of Go Ahead in the Rain, Notes to a Tribe Called Quest. Shauna Redmond, author of Everything Man, The Form and Function of Paul Robeson. And Ricky Vincent, author of Party Music, The Inside Story of the Black Panthers Band and How Black Power Transformed Soul Music. If you haven't already, you can purchase these books and many others at the Schomburg Shop, schomburgshop.com. From more than a year of experience now with this format, we know that virtual events are not the same as gathering in person, but we've learned that they do create some new opportunities for engagement. For example, when we get to the last portion of our agenda, if you want to ask a question of our speakers, you can click on the Q&A menu item, which for most of you will be near the bottom of your Zoom window, and just type your question into the box that pops up. We're also streaming live to YouTube, and we'll take questions there too. This event is being recorded and will be available for anyone to view after the fact on the Schomburg Center's YouTube page. By default, all of you watching this will remain anonymous in that recording. If we read out your question, we'll only mention your first name to preserve your anonymity. This is an important discussion. I'm certain we won't get to every question, but we'll do our best. Feel free to type your questions into the Q&A box at any time. And as I said, we'll get to them in the last part of tonight's agenda. And now I'd like to bring on stage Brooklyn College Professor of Political Science, Jean Theo Harris, a co-founder of Conversations in Black Freedom Studies and co-moderator tonight. Welcome, Jean.
Thank you, Brian. And welcome everyone tonight to our last event of the season. So we started Conversations, this is our ninth season. We started at Kamosi Woodard, who's a professor at Sarah Lawrence, and I, in conjunction with the Schomburg, started this series right at the beginning of January 2013 as a way to create more public space to talk about new work in Black history at a time when some bookstores were closing, when there were fewer and fewer places to go, to hear, to discuss, to be in community around kind of new books in Black history. And so it has been an exciting journey, and we have transitioned online this year, which makes it possible for so many new people to join us. So that has been a wonderful silver lining. And we're really excited about tonight. And we're gonna be welcoming, as Brian was saying, three writers. First, Hanif Abdurraqib is an award-winning poet, essayist, and cultural critic hailing from Columbus, Ohio. He's the author of a number of books, including A Little Devil in America, Notes in Praise of Black Performance. Welcome, Hanif. Shauna Redman is a professor of musicology and African American studies at the University of California, Los Angeles. She is also the author of Anthem, Social Movements and the Sound of Solidarity in the African Diaspora. Welcome, Shauna. And finally, Ricky Vincent is an author, historian, and radio host in the San Francisco Bay Area. He is a lecturer at the University of California at Berkeley and is also the author of Funk, The Music, The People, and The Rhythm of the One. Thank you all for being with us tonight and welcome. So I think we want to begin actually with a more personal question in terms of each of you giving us a sense of your journey to this work, to writing on the music of Black liberation. And Ricky, let's start with you, right? How did you come to this work?
How did I come to the Party Music Project? Well, they called us Panther Cubs. If you were a child of someone that was in the party, and there were quite a few because they had their own, I wasn't a part of it, but they had their own school, the Oakland Community School, which the Panthers ran. And so everything about the culture of the Black Panther Party had to do with one, self-determination, and two, sort of in a real investment in the community, a real presence in the community. So they were always present, even when my mother left the party. We lived through the 70s, single parent, sort of raised in the music and the culture and collecting the music. And just the energy, the resistance, the sort of the experience of Black power in the 70s. And I wrote in the introduction to Party Music that I saw Soul Train as an extension of Black power. And that might be a leap for folks that see Black power as something having to do with stoic militants in black leather, you know, sort of looking foreboding at different events. But it was more how people understood themselves, how people were sort of putting all the pieces of the Black identity together at that moment. So that was just an intrinsic understanding, and I wound up in the doctoral program at UC Berkeley, kind of looking at how to connect the music and the movement, like a lot of us do. And Boots Riley contacted me, he's a famous rapper from the coup, and he said, "Rick, did you know that the Black Panthers had a funk band?" And after laughing at that for a minute, I kind of looked at the significance of that, and was able to confirm this information, track down the music, and track down the performers, the members, card-carrying, rank-and-file members of the Black Panthers, not just supporters, but these are folks who had abandoned their musical dreams to join a revolutionary organization. And they said, I wanted to be a singer, but this movement now, 1968, 69, 1970, there's too much going on. And so I explored that. It took a while to really get these artists, these revolutionary artists, to open up, because they were, "Look, why do you want to talk about the music we did? I was a revolutionary, I'm proud of it." That was the narrative that I got. And it took a little while to sort of bridge that gap and make them realize that what they were doing is all connected. And kind of what we're doing here is connecting how the movement and the music has always been connected. And it's central to our learning of history, and it's central to our understanding of the music and how the music evolves. And so all the things sort of fell into place. I obtained a recording of the music, and they had transformed soul music standards. They had done People Get Ready by Curtis Mayfield, and it became People Get Ready, The Revolution's Come. They had, Santa might be familiar with Old Man River that Paul Robeson did. I mean, obviously she's familiar with it, she wrote the book, but the Black Panthers band redid that as Old Pig Nixon, and they sang the they all the structured harmony parts of the original song that Paul Robeson did, they were true to that. They were true to the structure of soul music. They were true to the form of Black music, but moved it in a militant direction. And so it was what you would call primary source material to expand on this question of, you know, the music and the movement. And by the, at that point, it wrote itself.
Thank you. Shauna, how about you? Tell us a little bit about your journey with this work.
You know, I didn't grow up in a typically musical home, so it's a long one of trying to figure out how to make meaning of my attachment to music, basically. So my parents, you know, by the time I was coming into more consciousness around music and my investments in it, my parents in the late 80s were, you know, listening to what the Rolling Stones and what Stevie Wonder was releasing at that moment. I didn't have any sense of them having a genealogy. I only knew them in 87 or in 88. And so by the time I got to college, you know, I was curious to know more. I wanted to actually have my eyes and ears open to the long histories of these people who were already a part of my listening practice, thanks to my parents in some small portion, but also wanted to make sense of how it is that every moment of my childhood is marked by a song or a musician. There's no single incident that I can recall from my childhood that I don't associate with some kind of musical practice. And it's not because music was always there, it's just that's now how my memory works. And so I wanted to make some sense of how that happened. And I was also in college becoming more and more radicalized, more and more politicized as I worked in organized labor and in racial justice movements. And by the time I was going to graduate school and made that decision to go, I was firmly committed to trying to merge those two elements, those two portions of myself. How do politics and music work together? And the more I read, the more research I did, the more I recognized and came to believe very solidly that where people struggle, people also sing and play. And so to offer some materiality to that, I pursued the Anthem Project, which became my first book, because I was also a student of diaspora and I wanted to know how Black people identified with each other. How did we come to believe in a we rather than a me and a you? And it was quite often through these shared performances where people literally had to sing together in order to move forward. And that those types of shared investments made possible this community of thought and action and solidarity that ultimately would become us, would become diaspora. So from that project, I did a lot of work on Robeson and Old Man River. And Robeson, who I never thought I would return to over any sustained fashion, ended up returning to me again and again and again. As I was trying to write other projects, I would always have this tap on my shoulder, look over here, look over here. And it was quite often poets who were taking me there. Gwendolyn Brooks and Nikki Giovanni and Pablo Neruda, all of these people wrote odes and treatises to and dedicated for Paul Robeson. And the more he recurred, the more curious I was about why. And why was he still here more than a generation after he had passed away? And hence came the project Everything Man. And again, giving me more and more insight into how people struggle. And they struggle in part through developing communities of listening, communities of performance, and calling back those people who made both of those things ultimately possible.
And Hanif, how about you? Tell us a little bit about your journey.
I feel like it's a little bit less impressive for a lot of reasons, but one primary reason is that I think that I grew up in a Black household where music was a language where there was no language, or it was a language that filled in the spaces where there were no language, particularly, you know, spaces after grief or after rage or after fear or after any emotion that was too large to articulate with words, there was music. And so I learned first of music as a communication point, as a place where I could feel a little bit less alone in my own universe. But also, I was fortunate enough to grow up with three siblings. I'm the youngest of four. And growing up with three siblings who loved music and were not selfish about that love and who would play the things they loved loud in the house, or who would give me access to the collect. My brother had this massive chest of cassette tapes and piles of Source magazines and these kind of things, where to me, music was a world building tool when I felt most alone. And it also helped me to make sense of history at a very young age. You know, I'm also from Ohio, which is, you know, I'm like 45 minutes from Dayton, which is where funk was, you know, funk rose out of Dayton, Ohio. And, you know, as I get older specifically, and I see how hard it has been for Dayton to cling to that history, you know, they had a funk museum that just cannot stay open out here, right? But the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame has no problem. You know what I mean? And I laugh because I was supposed to vote for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame this year, but I just don't care. You know what I mean? I just don't really care because I'm just not gonna, I don't need, there's no world in which I should have to argue for Fela Kuti being in the, like, build a name the shit after him. You know what I mean? Like that kind of thing where I began seeing through music and thinking about through music who gets an opportunity to archive and who gets to self-determine their own archive. And through that self-determination, who gets to name their own archive, right? And who gets to name the importance they had in the world. And I don't just think about this in Ohio with funk. I also think about it with like hill country blues and blues in the Delta, where a lot of those folks like weren't recorded. Like R.L. Burnside, Junior Kimbrough weren't recorded until the 90s. And what that did was make people believe that they'd materialized out of thin air in the 90s when they were playing in jukes for their people for decades and decades and decades. And so, so much of my work, I think, because I don't have any academic quote unquote training, like I was bad at college. I didn't go to grad school. You know, I spent much of my time, thinking about what is left, what will be left behind of the musicians I love. Not all Black musicians, but specifically Black musicians, because those were the ones I saw so often refused an ability to self-determine their legacies. And, you know, to play some small role in trying to correct that feels important for me at this point. I mean, with Little Devil in America specifically, it's not just Black musicians either. It's folks like Ellen Armstrong, the first Black woman magician to headline her own show. It's folks like Mary Clayton's musician, but it's also folks like, you know, folks who kind of orbit the world of Black cultural production and have committed to America in a way that America would never commit to them.
So we're now at the part of the evening where I'm going to ask you to teach us something. And when we talk about the music of Black liberation, we are talking about a wide diversity of music. And part of what is exciting about tonight and having the three of you with us is to really explore that range of music and musicians and the way it intersected with sort of Black struggle and Black revolution. So I'm going to ask each of you to tell us about some of that music and what changes in terms of how we understand the modern Black freedom struggle when we see it, when we hear it, when we understand it. And Sean, I'm going to start with you.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to say I missed my first opportunity to do so, but framing this as a teaching moment, I just want to acknowledge Ricky and Hanif for having been teachers for me. I rely on both of you in my classrooms, in my thinking. So I just want to thank you for the work you do. And it's beautiful to meet you both for the first time here tonight. And thank you, Jean and Brian, for having us and curating us in this way, because we belong together. So thank you for that. You know, I think one of the prefatory things I want to say in response to that question is to think about Paul Robeson's impact on music making. I mean, I think he, you know, is someone who, because of the kind of rabid attempts by the State Department to erase him from public memory, to convince people that he had never existed, we actually lose sight of a lot of his talents. Yes, he, you know, headlined the longest run of Othello on Broadway. He did all of these things, but I think what the left historiography has forgotten is that he was an instrument in a very kind of literal sense. His body as a vocalist, he was an instrument, but also he was an instrument for the people. And to actually take that seriously was something that was of importance to me. It was urgent, in fact, because we're seeing now this moment, because of the political context that Black people have created, this resurrection of certain of our figures, of our icons, in ways that may only be partially true or may only be partially reflective of who they actually were to the world. And part of what I'm pulling from Anthem into Everything Man is the argument that we know protest music through its use. And so to see how Paul Robeson is used even after his death is what actually allows for his impact. So I just wanted to best illustrate by reading a brief passage from the book, because I'm interested in tracking him in all of these different metaphysical forms. And through those metaphysics, we get closer to the answer of why is he still significant? And so this is one brief example of that. Tree marker number 2003-015 is a Magnolia virginiana. Set amid engineering and security buildings, it's the sweet, delicate counterpart to the rigidity of science, and one that might, if touched by the wind or rain in the right way, sing. The Paul Robeson Memorial Tree at Rutgers, New Brunswick, is a sweet bay magnolia indigenous to the southeastern United States and eastern seaboard that can grow to a height of 100 feet. The vanilla scent emitted from the off-white flowers is one of its trademarks that historically masked the otherwise horrid odor of its neighboring poplar trees. Pastoral scene of the gallant South, the bulging eyes and the twisted mouth, scent of magnolia sweet and fresh, then the sudden smell of burning flesh. The Princeton, New Jersey of Paul's childhood was described as for all the world like any small town in the deep South, and the fates of its Black women and men all too precarious. The penetrating violence of which Billie Holiday sang in Strange Fruit, that disclosed the ways in which the environment was weaponized against Black people, was a tangible reality for Robeson and his communities, and so he responded accordingly. In 1951, he, along with William Patterson and the Civil Rights Congress, authored and delivered to the United Nations a historic petition titled We Charge Genocide, in which they documented the mass slayings on the basis of race, of lives deliberately warped and distorted by the willful creation of conditions making for premature death, poverty, and disease. The ongoing presence of lynching and white mob violence was the motivation for the document, as well as Paul's tireless lobbying and public requests for a federal anti-lynching bill. The US federal government never saw fit to pass such legislation, and so Paul became a magnolia tree to crowd out the poplar and perhaps to provide a bit of comfort to those whose knowledge of trees is always paired with knowledge of the rope. So this is just one scene in which his transition into this other element, this time of the natural environment, is an opportunity to actually build new life worlds. That is an ongoing conversation that he's having, both with witnesses and those who plant him there, but also with the environment of which he's part. And of course, he was named by Mary McLeod Bethune as the tallest tree in our forest. And so the tree has always been a signature metaphor for his life and his impact, and reveals to me, again, because this is a new edifice, this is a new element of the Rutgers campus, that as these figures recur, we need to take seriously why they're back, who's bringing them back, and what work they're still accomplishing.
That image. Honey, why don't you go next and tell us about some of the music you're writing about and how it changes how we see or understand the Black freedom struggle?
Yeah. And let me echo Shauna and say that it's an honor to be here with both of you. Shauna, I read your work when I was working on Little Devil, and Ricky, your book on funk is like huge, not only for me as like someone who kind of grew up in the shadow of funk, but for a lot of people here, like for a lot of people in Ohio, that book has really resonated, I think, because that genre hasn't been archived in a way that I think is generous. So thank y'all both. I guess for me, I want to talk about gospel for a second, because I was raised Muslim, and I suppose I'm still sometimes Muslim. I'm fasting, so I have my water bottle here in case this goes past time of sunset and I can drink some water, but who knows? We're in like the home stretch of Ramadan, and I'm kind of, I've gotten in a good groove somewhat. But so I wasn't really raised in a gospel tradition, but I did live across the street from a church growing up on the east side of Columbus. It's a largely Black area. And on Sundays, I couldn't really hear the church, the music of the church from my house. But if I went outside, I could hear it. If I rode my bike past it, I could hear it. You had to walk by the church to get to the basketball court. And so I'd walk by the church Sunday mornings in the summer, and I could hear the music of the church rising out of the basement. And it always kind of, I was always drawn to it. I always felt good, kind of bathing in the noise that I did not yet understand. And I think that there's something in the long arc of gospel that I've been interested in, especially lately, as I've gotten a little older, and I've begun to think about Black music evoking a feeling of freedom that cannot be provided by the tangible outside world, which I think about often. And I think about it in two forms. I think about it a lot when I consider a Black artist hitting a groove that feels a multi-album groove that feels both unsustainable and miraculous. Stevie Wonder in the 70s, I feel like Sly Stone had a run like that. You know, early Aretha records, like the you know, non, like Lady Soul, Never Loved a Man, that kind of thing, where in the moment it's like, okay, this feels probably unsustainable. Like no one can create at this level. You know, Stevie's like another thing, you know, like that run is probably, that's just impossible. But I also think about it when music happens in a church. And now obviously since I've grown past my walking past the church of the basketball days, I've been in a lot of Black churches where a lot of gospel, like old Black gospel, is being sung. And I will never be able to access or get over watching the way that music lives in the physical bodies of people, which interests me, right? Because it is music that grants people a right to ascend to a better place, but not stay there permanently. And there's a type of ecstasy in that that I think is brief freedom, but freedom nonetheless. If we're talking about archives, I should obviously point out that Aretha did not want Amazing Grace to be in the world in the way that it was, which I struggle with that because I love the film so much. And I've watched it 2 times during the pandemic. I saw it 3 times in theaters. But in doing it, I am aware, of course, that Aretha did not feel good about the film. I know her family blessed it after she passed, but that's a complication. You know what I mean? Like, she physically was not present to give the film the blessing. And so I do feel complicated loving it the way I do, but I particularly love it for the movements that feel like competition that I've witnessed in the gospel space. But it's like a wholesome competition. There's a part of How I Got Over where the choir comes up over Aretha. She kind of glances back at him, you know, not in a mean way, but just kind of in the way where she peeps, she clocks what they're doing, and then she goes on top of them. But through that push and pull in the gospel space, this happens in music a lot where, you know, two guitarists are on stage dueling or whatever the fuck, but it's so much more interesting to me, and so much, it's less showy to me when it's a collision in a gospel space that feels like the end goal is to get people to that level of ascension, which does happen in Amazing Grace the second night. You know what I mean? You get people who are like in the aisles, you get Mick Jagger clapping off beat and all that shit. And you get folks who are the miraculous, and this, I mean, I'm honing in on Amazing Grace, but this speaks to my greater point about gospel as a tool of freedom. The miraculous thing that happens in that film is that we get to watch both nights. And so we get to watch the accumulation of emotion that leads to like never grow old, right? Where like Clara Ward's in the front row, like slumping down her seat because she can't believe what's happening. And Aretha's dad is like, even though he's seen it a million times, is still looking at the stage like he's never seen anything like it before. That is required. I think about gospel as a music that builds up in the body in a way that for me, no other music does. And I know that that may be my romantic lens on it because I didn't grow up listening to it, but the witnessing of that feels like it brings us closer to something, a temporary freedom that is very visceral.
Tell us about some of the music you're writing about and how it changes how we understand the Black freedom struggle, Black power.
It's on me. I was transfixed by Brother Hanif right there. I just want to echo what everyone was saying. I'm honored to be here. And Hanif, I have deep respect for the way you expanded from hip hop to our larger story. And those are some boundaries people tend to keep rigid. And John, I wish I could write like you. My career would be in a whole different place. Well, it's going through a lot of different directions, but if we're gonna talk about a high point, let me talk about the mothership connection. When George Clinton, after years of toiling for odds and ends of record companies and trying recordings here and there, he came across someone who had a blank check, who was ready to party all the time. That was a guy by the name of Neil Bogart. And he gave George Clinton free rein to do whatever he wanted on his live tours. After hitting number one R&B would Tear the Roof Off the Sucker, he took his whole band on the road. They called it the P-Funk Earth Tour. And I couldn't wait to go, but I was scared. I was young to go to the first show they did in Oakland. They did another one the second time in 1977. And what they did was for 3 hours of their show, of their 3.5 hour show, they would invoke, they would refer to this event, this, are you ready for the landing? The mothership will come. Are you ready? Can you bring it? Can you bring it to us? And we didn't know that they had the state-of-the-art props to bring down an actual spaceship across the stage. They had done some good deception, and they had a little rinky-dink one in the back of the stadium fly across. And while you're busy snickering at that, the thunder of the show kind of takes you over. And I remember as George Clinton is chanting on stage, "We have returned to claim the pyramids." I'm like, wait, what is he talking about? Wait, he's, you know, this is Oakland. What is he talking about, the pyramids? And he's drawing all these connections out, and the band is thundering. And I look at one end of the stage and there's four guitar players going. And I look at another end of the stage and there's five horn players. And then in the center of the stage, there's six vocalists all doing these gospel refrains, "Swing down, chariot, stop and let me ride." And I was not an ethnomusicologist at that time, but I noticed that they were referring to these traditions that they were claiming all belong to them, all belong to us, all belong to our history. And there was something knowledgeable and audacious about all of that in this moment of possibility, of expressing sort of Black possibility. Because when he brings down, the thunder brings down the ship, and it feels like this is something that Black folks could do. They could transcend, they could lift up, they could, Sly Stone said, "I want to take you higher." George Clinton built a ship and said, here, I'll take you higher. We're all going to take, you know, go to the chocolate Milky Way and do all these other things. But it was a very strong statement of what could be accomplished when Black folks had self-determination, when they could, when they were on their own terms. They brought their traditions with them and they created something no one else had ever done before. And so I would stick with that when I look at how much Black folks have had to do without those opportunities, with all the restrictions that they had, with the industry, with the demeaning stereotypes, with, you know, the poverty, all these things that are encroaching on your craft, your ability to tell the story of your people. And so the landing of the mothership, I think, belongs as part of the sort of evolution of the high moments in our musical story, in our history, right? And then you have the issue of these silences. And I was about to go on this whole thing, Shana, about how the silence of Paul, that the absence of Paul Robeson in the 60s made it, was the reason why so many of those 60s artists didn't necessarily write explicit songs about politics, because they knew the Paul Robeson situation could happen to them, right? And so to be able to start to speak with that freedom, James Brown did with Say It Loud, and Stevie Wonder did, and then and George Clinton builds on that. You know, that to me was epic. Then when I turned around and looked and I did the research, and even to this day, it's hard to find credible, Hanif, like you said, generous treatments of those moments in the journalism and the documentaries. It's very thin, considering how epic it was, how expensive it was, how thorough, what a big production that whole thing was, and all the tours, the Earth, Wind, and Fire tours. That should be stuff of legend in Black lore that we revere on our walls. Okay, but it's there's an absence there, and it hurts. And when I read about the mothership landing shows, the journalist said there were only a few white people in the stadium, and we huddled together. We were the journalists, and this is almost entirely Black operation. 1977 and 78, the era of integration, the era when all the multicultural, you know, disco bashes were taking place, and everybody's, you know, we moved past this racial thing, and here was something that was making the statement of the past, present, and future. And it definitely led to the future, because that's where hip hop sort of builds on. You know, here was this moment that kind of, if you weren't there, got missed. And for what it's worth, you guys, we don't tell the 70s story very well. There's plenty of work on the 60s and the struggle and the triumph. There's plenty of work on the terrors of the 80s and the war on drugs, war on urban America. But in terms of the triumphs, that you have to work on. That we have to kind of unlearn that and say what happens when we finally have self-determination? What happens when we can finally do these things? And what happens is, and I think it's innate, whenever there's that opportunity, we create, we build, we bring the traditions, we sing to each other, we tell each other our history through our music. And when we have the opportunities to do it, it is something to behold.
And I do think, you know, just to reference that, it signals to me what Hanif said also, right, about what does it sound like to grieve? Because I think about the 70s as a moment of real grief, right? The collapse of so much of what these movements had dreamed of. right? And so to think through, like Rob and Kelly, not of just our successes, but of the visions themselves. And that's where Clinton comes in. That's where Nina Simone continues to come in, right? All of these people who are actually seeing through the vision, even if the successes, the failures to meet certain end goals came up short. But I think that moment of the 70s is one of those really dense, tough to grapple with moments.
If you look at a lot of the 60s songs that have aspirational quality, someday we'll all be free. I wish I knew what it would be to be free. If you look at the 80s and 90s, the songs are about, well, back in the day, we were free. We could do things back in the day, it was better. Well, what was that day? That was that day where the sweet and the sour are all there together. That was that 70s moment. But we could, you know, for your next event, you could just play the Marvin Gaye "What's Going On" album all the way through, and that'll answer all those questions.
And then play "There's a Riot Going On." Play them back to back. You know what I mean? Play the Marvin and play the Sly Response album.
And then they'll know what's going on.
Yeah.
And you know, it's bitter, because I used to misunderstand the blues, and I didn't understand what that sad music was about until I understood how it spoke in metaphors, how it spoke to the history, how it spoke to the community, until I saw Sly Stone turn it sideways in a different direction. He had all the intimacy of the blues performance, all the connection, all the passion, all that was there, but it was, I'm free, but I'm not. You know, I can taste my freedom. Don't you know you are free, at least in your mind, if you want to be? But no, I don't have this. So it was this weird new level of irony. And that's where the sort of the funk essence comes in, because I have Black pride, I have Black pride, I have all this, but nothing's really changed. And how do you reconcile those two? Those are two extremely disparate rhythms, and that's what funk does. It sort of reconciles those rhythms.
Ricky, you kind of touched on a question I wanted to take us next. One of the questions we often think about in conversations is this idea of kind of the corrective, sort of myths, misimpressions, gaps in the way that we think about this, and in our case, kind of the role of music and the place of music in the Black freedom struggle. And I think you've started us off here in terms of like how we often miss the 70s and we, you know, the 60s and the 80s. And but I guess I wanted to hear each of you talk a tiny bit about something we need to see that we don't, something we get wrong, some myth we need to correct about the ways that we've so far conceptualized kind of the role of music in the Black freedom struggle or songs of liberation. Hanif, do you want to start us?
I mean, mine is short. I really want, I don't like saying we, cause I don't know who the we is, but I think that I've challenged myself to, correct my ideas as I've spent more time with them in the years of characterizing Black music makers and Black freedom fighters, particularly Black women music makers and freedom fighters, as only tragic figures or as figures who are defined by their tragedy. I feel like this happens with blues women a lot, but the arc of that is long. I mean, I think it happens in Little Devil. I talk about how it happens with Whitney Houston, you know? And I get that, it just seems to me that as a Black writer who's interested in the stories of Black people that zoom out and make them whole, to feed into and to continue narrative building that presents Black folks, particularly Black women, as only traumatic or only defined by their traumas, is not very useful. You know, like Tina Turner deserves better, you know, than what Tina Turner's got, because Tina Turner, talking about self-determination, Tina Turner has, despite her like actual literal best attempts, right, has still not been able to self-determine her own narrative for herself, sure, but in the machinery of the flawed and very binary and limited American imagination, it still hasn't worked out. And I can't think of too many other Black performers in my lifetime, at least. Of course, there are many, 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 but in my personal lifetime, who have strived to the level she has strived to correct her own record or to present something beyond what lives in the American imagination. And it just hasn't taken because of the obsession with the binary and because of the obsession with defining Black folks by harm, which of course, I mean, in order to get to the root of that, we'd have to go, you know, the whole country. I don't have to preach about that shit here, but because that still hasn't worked its way out of, you know, kind of American body and the American ecosystem, I think it is on perhaps me, at least as a writer, to consider the ways that I am feeding into that and the ways I'm withholding that.
Shana.
Yeah, briefly, I guess I would say, you know, one misconception or one thing that I try to disabuse use of is the language of soundtrack, that, you know, the music became a soundtrack to these protest cultures or a soundtrack to the civil rights movement, for example, because I think that actually shortens its impact. It doesn't actually allow for us to recognize and really grapple with the ways in which this music was a strategy, right? It was not just this ancillary background noise. It actually was taken up by people as the center of their organizing practice. Someone like Bernice Johnson Reagan, right? Who actually made it the center of how she moved politically in the world for her whole career, almost her whole life, right? So I think disabusing, you know, folks of the language of the soundtrack, even as revolutionary as a soundtrack has the potential to be, I think its use in relationship to social movements actually has been pretty limiting. And then I would just also say that we need not only consider texts, songs with lyrics, to actually consider them political tracks, to consider them politically significant for the communities that take them up. Again, these musics we know by their use. And so to pay attention to, you know, Abby Lincoln's screams, to take seriously Wadada Leo Smith's 10 Freedom Summers. Like, these are not just titles. These are actually built into the structure of what you're hearing. And so we have to be more attuned and have a finer kind of listening practice, a skill set around our listening that is able to consider more than just the words someone is speaking to us.
Can I just real quick, I love that Shana said that because I was talking recently about listening to Miles Davis at Newport that I don't know if it was a bootleg joint or something else, but there's a point where like his horn begins to sound angry. But it's definitely directed at this audience, you know, these audiences at Newport, which were often white, often wealthy, you know what I mean? And there's a point in, I feel like it had to be the bootlegs, the 55 to 75, because I remember listening and then being like, oh, something else is happening here. And it was the same stretch of performance, right? And it rewired my brain around how even our instruments, the instruments in the hands or protruding from the bodies of the right people are making a sound that speak toward visceral emotion. I mean, like some of the Nina Simone stuff where you can hear how hard she's hitting the piano, right? And rethinking. I mean, obviously the piano is a percussion instrument, but oftentimes I feel like it does not get treated as such. But if you listen on headphones to Nina Simone's Carnegie Hall stuff and listen to what's happening underneath the lyric, you can really hear her like hitting the piano fiercely. And I think there's a rage in that that is beyond language that deserves honoring too. So I just was really excited when Shana said that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also that there's this live element, and this is what I heard from you, Ricky, too, right? Like paying attention in these live sequences of performance, right? Because it's we listen to the record, we need that as part of our archive, but so much of what is been drawn out in these last couple of comments has been about having listened to live recordings or having been present for live recordings. And I think, again, we have to think about liveness as kind of a structuring logic of Black people's relationship to music making. And this is why it's so important in social movements, is because so much of how we organize ourselves is from the outside looking in, meant to be scaffolded by death. This is actually about life. So let's think about liveness as part of the practice of our political music making, because it's always present.
And that's an uphill battle. Thank you for laying that out, Shauna and Hanif, because it's, you're up against an industry that wants to do just the opposite and wants to dismember you and use digestible units. So you don't even think of the entire flow of this river coming down to kind of cleanse us all. You're just getting these little droplets of moisture coming at you. And so we miss it. And of course, you know, we haven't been live in a while. But, you know, I took a class from Ollie Wilson. He was this esteemed music professor. And I was gonna try to learn the history of Black music from him. And I did. But he said early on, if you're going to write about music, you have to be a poet. And I'm like, well, how am I going to start my career now? So you just said that. And, you know, because I want to try to capture that ethereal moment, that essence, because I know what it is. I've felt it. I've lived it. I want to use this language to transfer it and to share it. And forever, Black folks have been, Afro-diasporic peoples have been able to transfer that with apprenticing, being present at these live performances as the scenes evolve in all these different places and all these communities. So it's like an unspoken language of how the stuff propagates. And even with hip hop, and this is one of the things I do in my classes, because there was a real kind of break between families. There, hip hop had no elders in that sense. If you're in 1975 and your friends are rapping over beats and this and that, there was no one 20 years older saying this is how it's done. But they had their record collections, and their record collections became their elders. And so there was sort of a continuation of this, the little disembodied aspect from the kind of 70s to the 80s. But it's really, really hard to capture that essence of sort of what, you know, keeps the music and the people alive, and then explain it, transfer it in this format of language and structured scholarship and literature, and how it's sort of bigger than that, okay? And it takes people, Shauna's skill, Hanif's skill, to capture the magic in this. And I find myself just taking my historian hat on and saying, well, this happened here and this happened there. Something happened. What was the how did this transfer? Okay. How did the transition happen? I often talk about James Brown. He does a song called Super Bad in 1971. He couldn't do that song in 1961 because the climate of the times was such that he would have been on the tree, the Paul Robeson tree narrative instead. But times had changed, something had changed, the people had changed, and an attitude had emerged, and an awakening had emerged, and people had come around within that decade, right? Was it, can you measure that in lyrics? In some cases, yes. Can you measure the rhythmic intensity of that sound and those grooves? How do you translate that energy and that excitement And then, you know, we all know Aretha could deliver that on Respect, but she had a mean rhythm section driving that ahead, and she could move ahead of that. So, you know, this is where the language, the format, the intellectual format of Western history is lacking. It's not quite capable of capturing this. And it's an uphill battle for a lot of us to sort of lay this all out, draw the connections, and let people see what an amazing sort of continuity there is, right? There is a river.
This is going back to the very beginning, but Ricky had brought up Soul Train, and Soul Train as a hub of Black freedom, which was exciting for me to hear and interesting for me to hear, because when I work, I mean, Notorious, I've talked about this a bunch in interviews about Little Devil. I got this hard drive. A homie sent me a hard drive of every Soul Train episode from 1971 or two to 1989. And it was interesting because I grew up watching Soul Train reruns. But it's different when you're like a kid in the 90s, because you're not fully immersed in the world. You're watching an episode of something that was maybe filmed in 1978, but once a commercial hits, you're in like a Michael Jordan commercial or whatever the fuck, and you know you're back in the 90s. To kind of have this archive and to see the Johnson product commercials, the like Frederick Douglass Afro Sheen commercial and all that type stuff, it really immersed me in the world. And I also grew up, I mean, I feel like some people might argue this, but I feel like I grew up in the golden era of Black sitcoms, where there were just so many all the time. You know what I mean? Some of them I don't rock with, obviously, as eagerly as my parents did when I was younger. But still, you know, there's like, even beyond Cosby, there's Fresh Prince, there's Living Single, Martin, like so on. Golden era Black sitcoms. And so for a long time, I understood the only way to be Black on television in my current era was to have a family, a laugh track, something that began and ended within a half hour. In Soul Train, then and now, but especially now, thinking back, to watch Soul Train and to have this kind of simple platform of, we're just going to play songs and Black people are going to dance. And that's it. There might be a message tucked in that, but we're not going to really, you know. And it's just, it was so miraculous to me to watch the evolution of Soul Train from the early 70s to the late 80s, because I could have watched that with no sound on and had still had a glimpse into political shifts within Black culture, based off of fashion, based off of hair, based off of movement, all these things. Also, a thing about Soul Train, and I could talk about Soul Train forever and I won't, because I know that's not why we're here, but I was so amazed and so in love with how generous of a world Don Cornelius built, that where artists felt so comfortable, because there's those interviews where artists are just like sitting down in the literal audience that's circling them, audience of young folks, just answering questions like they're among their people, because they were, right? There wasn't a real hierarchy. Not to like, you know, I don't know everyone's age. I very well may be the youngest person here, so I'm definitely not gonna like back in my day on that shit. But it does feel like now there is a hierarchy built into the idea of celebrity that is so much more robust, that obstructs perhaps a real generosity.
Wow. How do you break that boundary down? We've rebuilt those. We're all connecting to each other in these 2x4-inch squares of digital projection. Mm-hmm. And we're not, like you said, encircling one another in this love circle, really, that can do. And I also want to, I've followed you right into the Don Cornelius thing, because he is, if you think about it, he's the sort of the next order of magnitude of what the Black DJs were back in the day, okay? And because they were the MCs for your day. They would introduce your day on the radio. You trusted them. They would give you the news, the public affairs, the subject matter, the slang, all the different flavors. And if people didn't like them, the community let them know, and they would either change or they'd be gone. So there was a whole lot of hands-on interaction, but between these folks that could consolidate what's happening in the culture, what consolidate what's happening in the movements, and make that information accessible on a day-to-day basis. And we forget how much Black AM radio or just Black radio was trusted, and how those people took that responsibility very seriously. Even if these were white-owned radio stations, they knew what folks were doing. And Don Cornelius built upon that tradition and sort of showed it, you know, this is, I mean, he showcased all these things. And if Don Cornelius put you on Soul Train, that was a level of credibility that you had earned. Even if it got a little shaky when you brought the Captain Tennille on there and had to adapt to disco and things like that, there were issues. But it means something. And we've kind of gone to the other end, other 180 degrees from that, from sort of a centralized idea of how we can think of the power and the beauty of our music and our culture, to now everything is decentralized and atomized, and everybody grabs their own music that they like at that moment, and historical context, understanding, deeper understanding, where is that coming from? You know, it's here and there. It's in venues like this, of course, but I have that concern a lot, that there's no Don Cornelius of the current world of our music.
Let me try to throw some audience questions into the mix here. We have a lot of them, and I'm going to try to batch them together where they have similar themes for you to tackle them. And one set is kind of about this question of historical continuities in Black music and maybe how you see the long view. Might be one way to say it, but let me read them out. An anonymous viewer writes, I'm wondering about the role of music as a sign of rebellion and seizing freedom in the Reconstruction era, transitioning out of slavery. What aspects of music and musical culture from that era continue into the music of Black liberation? Ron writes, did the Black liberation musicians ever look to jazz or blues as well as soul directly for their source material? And James asks, as we are blues people, as Amiri Baraka says, isn't it hard to separate the music, i.e. the soul, from the bodies of the people? Music articulates where mere words fail. Shana, you want to tackle any of those?
I mean, I would say yes to a portion of the latter question. Yes, as blues people, that's part of the investment, right? So just to hail Ollie Wilson again, he said that Black music is not fundamentally quantitative, it's qualitative. It's all of these things in concert with each other. It's studying the body and the instrument and the context and the home and the church and the juke joint, all of these dichotomies and juxtapositions that are making for the kind of richness of Black experience and Black life. All of that is in the music. The music, the music, this is our history, as Amiri Baraka said. So I think, yes, we have to be approaching it from this most capacious framework. And I think the best work actually does that. And perhaps that's why Professor Wilson also said we need to be poets, right? Is that we have to trust in kind of the sentience of these experiences and performances and kineticism that is being built through these moments of not only creation, but of listening, the intimacy that's created as I'm standing next to someone and we're hearing and witnessing the same thing together. There's something that's built there without words, absolutely. I think just as far as the longer genealogies of Black music, of course, there was a lot happening creatively, a lot happening politically during this moment of Reconstruction. And the blues are being developed in this moment as we're also hearing ragtime, people seizing the opportunity to take on musical instruments in a moment where they were previously denied to them, right? So we have all of these constant innovations that are happening because people are finding new ways of adapting their environment, adapting the tools at their disposal while also seizing upon new ones. So all of these things are contiguous, right? That there is no break, no gap, but it's really about listening for those bridges such that we might be in a position to actually dismiss genre altogether. Because while a helpful kind of shorthand, it's not always true to form, right? That to speak of the blues is not only to speak of the classic women that Hanif mentioned earlier, it's to speak of new addition, right? Like we actually have to be thinking about these forms as ever evolving, ever dynamic in people's listening, but also the ways in which they're picked up and created and built upon down the line.
Thank you. What about you, Hanif? How do you see these continuities?
Yeah, I mean, I can't really say anything better than what Shona said, honestly. And also just, yeah, I mean, like, you know, not less than 2 hours ago, I was talking about the Jasmine Sullivan record, that Hotels record as a blues album because of the communal, and a gospel album because of the communal nature of it. The multitudinous nature of the voices and the bringing together of a people to tell stories that are not. And I personally, you know, like, I think there's a difference between sadness and a rich understanding of deep suffering and the world's capacity to dole out deep suffering. And I feel like the blues falls into the latter category for me, where, because through that understanding also comes optimism, which is why, you know, for me, some of the best blues songs are like party songs, you know, or songs that are actually not about a predicament beyond romantic longing. Like, I don't know, like a song like Stay All Night is not that much different than Let's Get It On to me, you know, where the repetition builds and builds and builds, and then the desire becomes untenable and has to find somewhere else to flow into. I think that those are more, those are the blues songs I connect with most, because they are born, it seems to me, out of an optimism that is tied to an understanding of the world's capacity for in life's capacity to hold deep suffering, suffering so deep that we are not always aware when we're moving through it, and therefore we're not aware when we triumph over it, and therefore it feels impossible to triumph. There's a continuity in that, I think, particularly for Black folks, that again is not tied to, and this isn't me saying that we are bound to misery forever. It's actually saying that our optimism and our pleasures are that much richer because of that understanding. To poke a hole in the wall and to see what's on the other side and to even get to the other side, there's something richer in that than just being, than just ascribing sadness to an existence.
Thank you.
I like, in terms of that arc of the music, when Public Enemy put out Rebel Without a Pause and the beat stops and Flavor Flav says, bring that beat back, it always resonated historically with me. It didn't, I mean, yeah, the song was a lot of fun, but it made me think of the experience of people of African descent in the Western Hemisphere for 500 years been trying to bring that beat back. Okay, the drum was outlawed in the US, well, since 1619. The culture was one that you can't reflect your Africanness. You can't express yourself on your own terms. And gradually that beat would come back. Buddy Bolden would bring a beat with the cornet, that whatever the thing he was playing, and get people on the floor to dance. And there was this sort of constant tension between facing the moment or facing, you know, the possible future, that type of thing. And the beat was sort of growing in intensity all the way through the 20th century into the later period, where the beat got heavier and heavier. And then those industrial strength beats, the hip hop beats, the real big noise that EDM, we call it EDM now, but these are folks that just wanted to just sort of purge themselves of the tension through rhythms, right? And through these beats. And so it's been, to me, sort of an ever-present process of bringing that beat back into our lives. And in that sense, James Brown Africanized our music because he brought that beat back in a big way.
Thank you. There's a bunch of questions about the 70s. And I think picking up on what you were saying, Ricky, about the 70s, and I'm wondering if we could drill down into this a little bit more. Several come from our viewer, Ben, who writes, speaking of the 1970s, I'm wondering whether Ricky Vincent has at all reconsidered the view of disco that he presented in his book on funk as a kind of commercial phenomenon that messed up funk. Is there a more positive way to historically situate disco in the 1970s? How does Donna Summer fit in to the narrative of Black music in the 1970s? She was a huge star. Rahab writes, the 70s were about the struggles in Africa and Black cultural nationalism combined music with poetry, i.e. Gil Scott, the Watts poets and the Last poets. The music was messages like Quilts and the message slash maps of the Underground Railroad. Black Panthers had a band, East and West Coast had South African troops, Sounds of Kenya, even Bob Marley's music. Revolutionary sounds, the spaceship, the mothership, things that you've already mentioned. Pharoah Sanders, et cetera, jazz, Yusuf Lateef is an example of artist and music and message. Is there more to say in response to these comments about the 1970s and how you all see the music of the 1970s? Let me start with you, Hanif.
Oh, no,
I guess I should start with Ricky since he was directly called out. Sorry. You're right.
Well, that addressed something I'm working on. I was asked to do a new introduction to the funk book, specific for a Russian publisher. It's going to be out in Russian before the new American edition. That's a long story. But I made a point to address that question because the disco movement, first of all, I have to say, in 2011, I accepted disco into my life, and it's changed, it's allowed me to really enjoy stuff that as a music snob, back in the day, you know, I didn't. And I also understood that the whole scene of disco was a way for a community that had been discriminated against in ways that folks are still trying to understand. The LGBTQ community through disco found its own space, its own place of being, its own way to thrive on its own terms. And so that's a parallel thing. And so I frame it as two epic narratives occupying the same space. Okay, so the rise of disco and a way to sort of think in much more in gender fluid constructions of what freedom really is. And then you have this sort of Black tradition of funk music that is sort of being ignored through the industry's machinations. And that's what I talked about in the funk book a lot. But you know, disco really created the dance world that we have today, the dance music industry, the 12-inch single, all of these things. But it's pretty obvious at the time it was there. It was creating a space for people that wanted to be on Soul Train that couldn't dance. And so they made their own Soul Train, okay? And, you know, once you frame it like that, then it's, you know, just everybody's good. Let's start the party. It does do things like emphasize the DJ culture, which reduces the sort of infrastructure of music entertainment, and it puts a lot of musicians out of work. And then the emphasis on the DJ culture is how and why and where hip hop emerged, right? So a lot of these magnificent things emerged when disco rose, but at the same time, it was a artificial sort of clamping down on this rise of thriving funk bands, which 50 years out, you guys, this goes to, Hanif, one of the things you said at the beginning about the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. You have lifelong artists like the Barqués, like even Kool and the Gang, Cameo, bands like this, War, that could not get on pop radio later on in the 70s. And now the people that could give them lifetime recognition, they're not as familiar with them. They don't know them like they know the Eagles or like they know Elton John and stuff like that. When these folks have their lifetime body of work, there should be, you know, an epic infrastructure for them to get that type of thing. And it'd be great if we could do it on our own. It'd be great if, the Black Arts, the Black Rock Coalition could build something that could really get us, you know, to recognize the greatness of a generation, of these generational works that tie all our traditions together. But that's another example of this sort of silencing, this emptying, this sort of forgetting that is troubling. So disco bands are in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Funk bands, no.
Thank you. Hanif.
I feel a little, I don't know. I feel out of place answering this. I know that my musical archival, my musical memory is very rich in the 70s, but I wasn't born in the 70s. My connection to the 70s is through the music my parents loved, that I was familiar with through them. They were kind of my vessels to it. I will just say really quickly, though, I think an important thing about disco and funk that I repeatedly return to is I also see the seeds of hip hop in those genres. And of course, like, not just the seeds. When we start talking like the 90s, even late 80s, it's not just the seeds, like the sonic blueprint is there too. But also I think the seeds of hip hop, not just the music, but the actual culture. I do see funk and disco playing a role in that, that I think is a bit, that gets a bit undervalued. But I hear it and I sense it. And I like historically see it. Like it didn't just begin when George Clinton like signed over his catalog to Dr. Dre or whatever, you know what I mean? It was there before that. Not, maybe that's being a little ungenerous about that transaction, but you know what I mean? Like when Dr. Dre like steeped the Chronic in those George Clinton samples, it didn't begin there. And so I do think that, you know, and I don't know. My feelings on disco, I've always loved disco. And I think a part of that is because I also understand, like when I detach, because I wasn't alive for it and because I didn't live through that era, I'm thinking about it merely in terms of the careers it kept alive. Like I think Grace Jones needed disco in order to build a bridge towards her Compass Point era, which is like a great era of music. But she needed those disco albums. As maligned as they might have been at the time, they were kind of like small bridges to get her to another place. Because the Compass Point shit isn't that, like, it's not that much different from her disco stuff. It's just better, you know? And so there are some careers I think that I really value that were held up and kept alive through disco. And I feel like that's important too.
Thank you. Shanna?
I don't have much to add other than, you know, the types of listening that I do quite often around the 70s, in addition to the funk bands, are like the Black women balladeers, those people who are putting out power anthems in that moment. And so just thinking again about these continuities, like they are reminiscent to me of the blues women in many respects. I Will Survive, all of these songs that come out in the disco era are doing a work for those communities in similar respects to what the blues women were doing in the 20s and 30s. So I think there's a lot still to be mined and excavated in that moment, as Ricky earlier said.
I want to sneak in a question of my own about Black vocal performance and how you see its unique innovations, textures. I can't think of a better word than innovations. And when I think about some of the people that you write about, that is a distinctive element of it. When I think about A Tribe Called Quest, there's distinctive vocalizations that struck me as so new and so innovative when I heard them. When I think about Paul Robeson, and you talk about him as an instrument of the movement and as a musical, his body is a musical instrument. His voice is so distinctive. And I don't know as much about the band that emerged out of the Black Panther Party and those eras, but I'm wondering if you could tie together a conversation about Black vocal work and innovation through the different kinds of artists that you write and think about. I'll start with you, Ricky.
I want to quickly defer to these folks that have written brilliantly about the sounds of these great people. I have a friend of mine who works, who's writing a dissertation on that high note that we hit, that Black ecstatic, that scream, that high pitch. I forget if there's a term for it. I don't know what it is, but we all know that note that Prince can hit, that ow, that sort of peak, and it's in all of our music traditions. Okay, and some folks can master it. Prince can do a whole song in that sort of level. And it's just something that we sort of know is ours, and it makes it real to our lived experience. But it's sort of the culmination of what's already making it real, which is the way the tension builds, the way the anticipation works, you know, the tension, the release. All of these are well-hewn elements of our music. That's why we still listen to Marvin Gaye like he's brand new.
Shannon?
Yeah, I mean, once you've heard Paul Robeson, it could be no one else. If you ever hear his voice again, you know instinctively that that's who you're listening to. And this is in part what makes it possible for me to argue in the book that he becomes a hologram later in his career, is because the holographic, to my mind and to my argumentation, is a sonic science as much as it's a visual science. So because his body is his instrument, you can actually hear all of the boundaries as he's singing, his lungs pulsing, his chest cavity opening, his throat getting into position, attuning to his environment. And so if you can hear the borders of his body, then you can see it in circulation, and that's his hologram. But his voice, you know, part of the reason it became so distinctive is not just because he continued to circulate as a stage star, a film star, et cetera, but because he had lived a life in rehearsal, that he was constantly preparing for something else, for the next big battle, the next big role, the next song, the next language that he was going to learn, right? He spoke and sung in more than 24 languages. So he was always in rehearsal, which maintained this fantastic athleticism that was generated by him being a four-letter athlete, as well as having played in the early NFL. So because he was already in training and always in rehearsal, he was able to maintain a certain kind of consistency of his vocal capacity that meant for a 40-year career, literally. And from day one of hearing him revolutionize the art stage in 1925 to his retirement around 1963, you're able to hear that continuity and know that it is distinctly him, because he's bringing to it all of these years of training, all of these years of rehearsal, but also a very presentist command that he could take over a room like no one else because of having built that endurance. And so to pay attention to those intricacies in the voice is to get to know his person better, know his body, his instrument better, but also to really take stock of the thought and care that he was putting into his performances, because he thought of and cared so much for those who were listening.
Thank you. Hanif, your thoughts?
This is great. I really appreciate hearing from everyone. And I will say that you know, with regards to Tribe, it's interesting. Last month I worked on a thing for Fife that I think is out now, but about his album that's coming soon. And in talking to Fife's friends and family and former bandmates and whatnot, I think it was Ali Shaheed Muhammad said something interesting about how it was important that people, this isn't about Fife, it's about Q-Tip, but people categorize Q-Tip as a jazz singer or as a jazz vocalist because of what his voice could do tonally to match the soundscapes on those first, on the middle two albums specifically, on Low End and Marauders, right? And how it was effortless for him to kind of keep up with someone like Ron Carter in the backbones that Ron Carter was building with the bass lines, and how Q-Tip could kind of sound like a horn if he needed to. You know, I have a lot to say about Black vocal performance singing wise, but I think because I'm a child of hip hop, I'm still so fascinated by the nuances of things like breath control, like someone like Black Thought, who still is almost like an endurance athlete, right? And has crafted an ability to rhyme that feels so relentless because of how much air he's holding and how he's kind of doing sometimes what seems like really circular breathing on these on the back end of these bars. You know, someone like Queen Latifah too, in her prime, folks who, I love rappers who really, I mean, Queen Latifah was so good at just attacking a beat before it could get a hold of her, you know? The late DMX as well. One thing I thought about, and DMX, you know, for those who knew, like, went through a lot of phases. He was DMX the Great, and then, you know, after he didn't get signed for a bit, he kind of switched up his aesthetic, and then he switched up again, and he was the DMX that many people knew in the wider world. But the thing about, like, the thing I thought about after he passed, and I listened to some of his older stuff, I think about Swiss Beats as a producer, right? So much of what I think Swiss Beats is trying to do is create a jumble of noise that, like, by default overpowers rappers. Like, I think all the time about Jay-Z, you know, like, whatever my feelings on Jay-Z are now, I do believe that Jay-Z at one point is a very good rapper. And I think about, like, On to the Next One, where that beat, Jay-Z just could not, he was so, you could tell he was so beat back by it, that by the end of the song, he should have just, like, let it be an instrumental. But DMX was so good at just taking those beats apart. You know, as ferocious as those beats were, he never let them get on top of them. And there's a real art to that. And it's easy to identify it, I think, in the boom bap era, where you could tell when folks were almost trained to get on top of those beats. But when rap became so sample heavy, the second wave of sample heavy, you know, because it was sample heavy, like hella sample heavy. We're talking like Tribe and Bomb Squad and all that. But this second wave of sample heavy, where it's kind of like Diplomats, Heatmakers, Kanye West, Just Blaze. I find that rappers sometimes have a hard time not getting overtaken by a beat. And so I admire the vocal performance of someone like a DMX or someone like a Black Thought, who really does not let a beat get on top of him. Someone even like Flo Milli, I think too, is in that camp.
Mm. Thank you. I think we have time for one more question for each of you, kind of lightning round, and please add any last thoughts that you've been wanting to say all night. What music are you listening to now? What albums or artists are sustaining you in this moment? Ricky, can we start with you?
Okay. Well, I got to finish the thought that Hanif gave me, and that was some still in mourning of Greg Jacobs, Shock G, Humpty Hump from Digital Underground, who had multiple styles and could master all kinds of different rhythms and beats. And he made the beats, and he was a musician on top of his work, and still kind of in that sunken place around losing him so unexpectedly. Who am I listening to now? I was listening to Salaam Remy's Black on Purpose to get juiced up for this conversation today. There's a guy out of the DC area, Joe Keys in the late Bloomer Band, and he sees himself as kind of a mix of Sun Ra and Gil Scott-Heron with a club beat, and it's so full of life and consciousness and wisdom and jazz and everything. And his new album is due out, but I have an early version, which makes it better, right? The early.
All right.
So that's what I'm listening to, because there's so many people that bring the live music experience out to you, even on a little machine. It still feels that way.
Amazing.
I'll stop there.
Thank you, Ricky. Hanif.
I'll just say real quick that I'm revisiting Groove Theory and listening to the Floating Points Pharoah Sanders album a lot.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was going to say the Pharoah Sanders is on my docket to listen. And, you know, the speaking of Swiss, you know, the versus battles have me back in SWV at the moment, very happily. I'm also listening to Kia, whose album we all know, I'm sure, is amazing. And I'm also listening to younger musicians who are connecting a lot of these political questions in really interesting ways. People like Samora Pinder Hughes, who I think is amazing, a phenomenal jazz musician and student.
SWV has so many good songs. I'll just say that, like SWV, whenever, because I'm like Shauna, when the SWV thing got announced, I was like, isn't SWV an escape? Is that it? Yeah, like I know Versus is no longer, and it definitely should not be this way. I think my like athletic competition brain gets in the mind of like, I wish it was like a song for song battle, but it probably should be more communal than that. But I saw someone was like, I don't know, if it were that way, I don't think Escape has the songs. And I was like, oh, that's probably not true. But then I was like, let me revisit SWV. And I was like, holy shit, they got so many, so many songs. Escape has good songs too. Don't get me wrong. Like Escape has some tunes. But like, there's a difference between having some tunes and like having like what SWV has.
And remixes on top of it, you know, that kill. So yeah, it's all the things.
We could go all night. This has been such a fun conversation and an amazing conversation. And maybe we'll do it again. This does it for Conversations in Black Freedom Studies for this series, for this season, sorry. We're on break and we'll return in September, always the first Thursday of the month. Thank you so much, Ricky Vincent, Shauna Redman, Hanif Abdurraqib. Thank you to Serena Rockhauer and Eric Wallenberg, who have worked behind the scenes to make this season possible and to make it run as smoothly as it does. Thank you, Jean Theo Harris and Kamozi Woodard, who founded this series. On behalf of the Schomburg Center and the New York Public Library, I just want to say stay safe, everybody. Please buy the books. Thank you so much, and we'll see you next time. Take care.
Thanks. Good night, everyone.
Okay, Ross. Go away.
Backlash, Mr. Backlash. Just who do you think I am? You raise my taxes, freeze my wages, and send my son to Vietnam. Give me second-class houses and second-class schools. Do you think that all colored folks are just second-class fools? Mr. Backlash, I'm gonna leave you with a backlash blue. When I try to find a job to earn a little cash, yellow, beige, and brown, Mr. Backlash.